Okay, bom dia. We have the first lecture on solar applications today. Or we will have an introduction to solar applications. What type of conversion systems are general topics? And by that, we will start with solar electricity today, so PV modules. Okay, solar applications in general. Of course, you know that the energy demand over the next 30 years, 40 years, always increasing. So people need more and more energy because more and more people are in the world, and they use more and more things which need energy. And by that, the forecast shows projections here increasing the total world energy consumption. And you see that there, besides the fossils, there are also renewable energies are one part out of it, of course, but we have still going up 39% up to 2040. This is the newest energy outlook from this year, 2016. Okay, units, very important, because the numbers get so big that we need new, you all know about a kilojoule or maybe a megajoule, but we are not even in gigajoules, terajoules, we are up to petajoules, and we will come to exajoules in a few years. So the number is getting really, really large here. Energy units are measured for all these consumptions by British thermal units or by a ton of oil equivalents, or you can think of a barrel. Which is traded in Rotterdam or where else, and a barrel will be then converted to this TOE, ton of oil equivalents. Okay, you see that the numbers are very big. This British thermal units is the work which has to be done to increase 1 pound of oil. This is the old system, you know, but still all this trading, started, of course, from the British, and so it's still used in these old units, which are not the SI units. By that, all the numbers gets something which is a little bit odd then at the end, you know. But this is the way, okay. So 1 pound of water by 1 degree Fahrenheit as well. But we are not with 1 BTU, but we are talking about quadrillion BTU, and this quadrillion BTU is in the British sense 10 to the power 15 BTUs, and then we are, if we transferred the BTU to joule, we are at 10 to the power 18 joules. Okay, and then with 18 joules, we are at this exajoule. Yeah? Oh, okay. Ton of oil equivalent, this is the energy which is inside if you burn 1 ton of crude oil. This is about 7.3 barrels. And you see that this comes up, 1 TOE, to about 40 gigajoule. Okay, we have their exajoules, we have their gigajoules. Sorry, and all in the statistics you see, they are either in BTU or in TOUs, TOE units given. So the primary energy consumption, which is all the energy used on the world in 2012, this is the last one, per year, is 550 watts per year, and this is about 152 petawatt hours per year, or 13 gigatons per year of crude oil, which has been burned as equivalent. Okay, so very large numbers. So now we'll see who is consuming the energy. I made two comparisons here, USA, China, and Brazil and Germany. Before you come to this, go on the left-hand side. On the left-hand side, you see the by countries, the shares of energy consumption. You see, of course, that China and US always almost take 20% each of the total. So 40% of the cake is consumed by the US and by the Chinese people. And then you see Germany and Brazil, about 2%. Germany, Brazil here. Germany, Brazil, 2% in 2014. And now you see the development over the years. In Germany, almost stable at that level, about 320 mega TOE per year. And in Brazil, very fast increasing energy demand. This is clear, very young demographic. So we have a lot of young people that are increasing numbers of inhabitants, 200 million, I think, in Brazil, or 210 million people. In Germany, a little bit going down, 80 million something. And all the people, they are used, they want to have cars, refrigerators, whatever, so increasing energy demand. And of course, the industry needs a lot of energy. So it's always a share between industry, between transport, mobility, and the households, what needs the energy. Okay. Good. On the other side, the major mega players here, the US and China, you see the same development. In China, very rapidly increasing, and the break-even was around 2010, that now China needs more energy than the US. Okay. If you divide it through the inhabitants, which is not really true, because, as I said, not all the energy is consumed by the private households. Most of the energy is consumed by mobility and by the industrial, though it's not so fair. But on the other side, it gives an impression how much energy is used per inhabitant, per person. And you see that in the US is the highest energy consumption. And then in Germany, it's about a half of that, and maybe then two-thirds is Brazil already. And you see what is the development. The development will be that this comes up and this will not go down, as you see here. It will stay somewhere. So in the end, all the energy demand, the global, will increase. And that's what's given in this forecast up to 2040. 38% of increase. So there is a lot of thinking how to provide the people with that energy. And can we provide this? And by what means, of course. Okay, how is the energy shares? Again, comparing now this 2% Brazil, 2% Germany, how it's the shares. And you see in Brazil, the energy consumption comes from 44% from oil. Of course, you have your national oil reserves, Petrobras, offshore oil, and so on. Though this is consumed, you all use that oil. And then you see on the other side, if we count we add up the renewable energy shares, which is the hydro, all this, what is given here is renewable, but also the biofuel, you come up to 39%, which is very high for Brazil because of the hydropower you have. Okay. On the other side, in Germany, the cake is almost the same size, 2% of the world energy demand. We see here that the share of the energy, of the renewable energy, is about 11%, the one-third of that, roughly. And we are also using mostly oil and gas, and then comes the coal. Coal is not playing such a big role in Brazil. So that's, now talking, of course, on these renewable energy shares, and now we'll see how much is this in PV, in photovoltaic systems. Okay, so the sun, is that with us from the first lesson? We can use the sun to provide this energy which is demanded in the future. And one of the things, of course, wind, air, water. We have talked about the wind, the sun. Okay, now it comes to the sun. Why the sun is always shining? Of course, this is a nuclear fusion reaction. Hi, a nuclear fusion reaction. And this nuclear diffusion reaction has a radiation. This radiation we call sunlight, but the radiation is much broader in the spectra than the visible light, which is just something between 300 and 700 nanometers. You know or know that there is hard X-ray, gamma ray, which is blocked by the atmosphere, don't come down here, which is very nice from the atmosphere. On the other side, we have an UV part, we have a visible part, and we have an infrared part. Okay, and these parts are some, of course, in the atmosphere, the molecules, the molecules will absorb energy, so some of this specific wavelengths of the bands are missing, so we have at the end a solar irradiation spectrum which has a maximum around 500 nanometers and with a long tail down to about 2500 nanometers. Okay, outside we're here on the ground, we are in this red region, or this we count with this red spectra here. Okay. Maximum at about 500, you can calculate black body radiation. What is the temperature of this nuclear fusion reaction? Of course. Okay. Okay. Now comes to the solar radiations and the geographical latitude. Two things we have to think. So the sun is shining, of course, on the globe, but it's shining in a different way because the angle of the globe is twisted, is turned to the sun. So we have in the northern parts where we have a larger latitude, the path length through the atmosphere is longer as at the equator. The equator, you have a shorter, it's direct, it's perpendicular if you want, a shorter path length. So the attenuation of the solar energy is here larger and is here not so large, smaller. Okay. On the other side, you have a projection effect. So the same intensity is shining here on a smaller area and here it's divided onto a larger area. Okay, so this gives clearly that the solar intensity will be here around the equator larger than in the upper north and down in the south. Okay, so it depends on the geographical latitude. Okay, to count or to see what is the insolation, that means the energy which comes on the ground per year as a function of the geographical latitude and for taking care on the path lengths through the atmosphere, people have counting or referring everything to the air mass. And this air mass concept will come in the next slide here. So the air mass is important because we in the lab will have later on to normalize the spectra which we measure with our glass. We'll have a glass, a front glass for a PV application. And this is then measured in the spectrometer. The spectrometer, of course, has a light source. The light source has not the same spectrum than the sun. So we have to normalize, we have to weight all the wavelengths by such a normalized spectrum. By that we need a normalized spectrum. What is the normalized spectrum of the sun? And that is given here with this air mass. So what we normally have to do in the lab, of course, we have some light source in a normal UV visible near infrared. You have a halogen lamp and a deuterium lamp. two lamps, and they will be changed deuterium to provide UV light. And this is then, of course, you have then a monochromator or something, slits or a prism or whatever. And then you have your glass sample. And after the sample, you have some detector, okay? So we'll have to find some way to normalize the light of these lamps to the light which the sun is shining. Because at the end, we want to have information on the solar transmittance of such a glass produced in a flat glass industry, if this is a good one or if we have too low transmittance values, okay? And I show at the end how that's done in the lab. Okay, so welcome to this optical path length through the atmosphere, and this depends on the latitude. And you see that outside, where we have no atmosphere, they use an AM0 spectra. This is only for the satellites which are outside the atmosphere, so they get the full radiation. And then we have the one atmosphere. The one atmosphere is used for AM1, is used for all the equatorial regions, so northern of Brazil, north, 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 where it goes to the equator, and down here in the south, as well as up in the north in Europe or North America, you use a 1.5 AM, RMS 1.5, and this is used, and this is then the standard, because the most of the people are living in latitudes which belong to these 40 to 50 degrees in the zenith angle. And by that, you can see that from the solar constant, which is not a constant, but because you know there are solar eruptions a few years, we have a little bit more, and then we have a little bit less. So it's not really a constant, but we can count with about 1.367 kilowatt per square meter. And this is then going down course of the atmosphere, and then there it depends on how long it's going through the atmosphere, and this is given by this latitude or this zenith angle. Okay, so at the end, or this is a short formula to calculate it. It is normalized for the 1.5, and you see what comes out roughly 1,000 watt per square meter. That's what you have to know, 1,000 watt per square meter. And then this is used, this spectra is used as a reference for the solar industry, AM 1.5. So if you measure something, you have to measure, you have later on to refer your result to AM 1.5 to weight some wavelengths stronger than the other, because the sunlight has this appearance here, and this is a 500 nanometer. The 500 nanometer counts much more than about 2000. They have to wait at the end this. Okay, so this is the concept, and this is given as a standard. You can download this as an Excel file. It's a public file everyone uses, and it will be corrected every, I don't know, 2-3 years, because the sun is a little bit different. And that's what people are used to give standards, to have a standard, to give measurements, or to see what is the performance at the end of their PV module. And for that, we need this reference, okay? So the reference is given here. Okay, by that, you see the calculations. Insolation is then the integral of the solar irradiance over a time period. Normally, it's 1 year. And so you can calculate the total energy. It's a direct energy, then it's 10% diffuse energy, and then on the ground, if this is with an angle, then there's of course a reflected energy from the ground up. So if you count these two and this diffuse part, this is the 10% which is given here, inside here already. So you can calculate by that. And then you see if we are with AM 1.5, we end up about 1,000 or 1 kilowatt per square meter. And then you can count now, 7 hours sun per day, 7 kilowatt hours per day, or 2.5 or 2,555 kilowatts hour per square meter and year. And that's what is given here. You see here the 2,700, and here is an average daily sun hours, 7. So that's how to read the scale here. And by this scale, you see that there is, we call sun belt. So in the center, as expected, we have the largest insulation, and in the south and in the north, it's lower. So the colors here going from red to green and blue. Okay. So insulation and insulation with O, and the other is with U. Yes. Okay. So now we compare again Brazil and Germany. You see in Brazil the colors are in this yellow range. So I picked that the average about 2,000 kilowatt hour per square meter, and you see it's more in the northeast regions here. I don't know, this is Bahia, what is this? Pernambuco, or I don't know who's up there, who's which states. So they got the most of the solar energy, you know that. And of course, if you go down to Rio or so, you see it's a little bit green there down. In Germany, you see it's mostly green, and we are around here, 1,000. So it's a half of that, like in Brazil, if you do just an average. And you see in Europe, to come to the same regions, we have to go to the south, to the Mediterranean Sea, to see that, or to north of Africa, or to Turkey, or to the Mid-Asia countries here. In South America, of course, it would be most or the best to go to Atacama Desert in Chile. There's the highest solar radiation, yeah, on the other side of the Andes. Okay, so now comes the types of solar conversion systems. And you see by that energy, or we can use that energy to convert it into electricity directly using a photovoltaic cell. We can heat something up, that is solar heat, we'll see that next time. We can use that to run chemical reactions to produce hydrogen, for instance, as a solar fuel. Or we can use it by photocatalysis to clean water. And these are the technologies which are used. And all these technologies are glass inside, and we'll introduce glasses today here for photovoltaics. Next time we'll do that, and then we'll come down to this. Now this is one of them. With all of that, of course, is the industry and special demand for glasses, glass surfaces. We'll have a course, we have a lesson on the surfaces, how to coat them, how to treat them, etc. Because you know, photocatalysis, the glass itself cannot do this, but a semiconductor on the surface of a glass can do it. Okay. So, okay, there comes to this fifth chapter on the PV. Now we go to the first one, direct conversion of the solar energy to electricity, okay? Good, so here are the PV shares again, Germany, Brazil. You see in Brazil, 0.1, though it's not yet developed. It just started, I think, 2 or 3 years before, in 2013. In Brazil, and though it's a very, because most of the electricity is produced by hydropower, so though it's not a big market, not yet, it will come in the future, maybe. And it depends how much water you have in these dams. There was a water shortage, I think, last year. All the represas were down, and so you, if that is down and the water is needed for water supply of the people, they cannot produce electricity with it. Yeah. So, and then by that, something else. So it also has to go the way of diversity. You have to have shares of different types of energy conversion systems. Okay, so far 0.1%. In Germany we had that, the total share of renewable much lower, 1/3, but from this 1/3 is about 6% the electricity share with photovoltaics, here photovoltaics, so this is a lot already for the small Germany. Okay, so in Germany it's important, in Brazil it maybe will be important in the future. Okay. So I want to introduce you to the energy payback time, that's the time which is needed to at least produce as much as energy which has been spent for the manufacturing of the solar cell, including all the installation around, including the transport, including the raw materials, refinement of the silicon, drawing the silicon single crystals and so on, making the glass, the cover glass, all this includes this. And this is something which is given up here for a rooftop system, standard crystalline silicon. This is the first generation. This is a standard PV module. And you see, it depends, of course, on the irradiation of the sun and how much sun is shining per day. And you see that in Germany, with around 1,000, this calculation here of 2014 gives about 2 years. Okay, in 2 years, the energy which has been spent to produce the module has been converted from the sun to electricity. If you now think on a module should at least have a lifetime of 20 to 30 years, it is 10 times producing more energy than it has been spent for production. So it's meaningful to use that, of course. And then you can, of course, calculate that back, how much kilograms or tons of CO2 you have used for the for production manufacturing, how much you will not use, because over 20 years you produce this electricity, okay, without comparing to burning CO2 or something like that. Okay, to have a carbon footprint also. And you see in the south, of course, these values going down to about 1 year. If you think now in Brazil was 2000 around, so we can say about 1 year. Okay, then there's another study made in Brazil here 3 years ago from the USP, University of Sao Paulo. I put this, and they have a little bit conservative or more global thinking on everything. Maybe the first study has not included everything which is needed, but here also the transport comes, because the PV modules are not produced in Brazil, so everything has to be transported from somewhere to the northeast of Brazil or somewhere. You see here, so it comes up a little bit higher values, but at least you see the energy payback time in years, about 2 years, 2.6 years up to 3 years in this calculation for Brazil. Then they conclude 30 years, a life cycle of a PV module, and they said, okay, 30 years, up to 3 years, so 10 to 12 times it can produce more energy as has been spent for the manufacturing. Okay, and this has been calculated for the north, Belém, and to the central, Belo Horizonte, down to the south. This is in the south, or? Yes, okay, this is in the south. Okay, and you see the values. So it's a little bit lower than the 2000, which was on the scale. So they are running there, I think, with lower values a little bit. But at least you see the calculations are the same. And 10 times, roughly, is that what can be more produced and spent for the manufacturing, shipping, transport, installation, all the system around, which has to be connected to the grid, things like that. Okay, this is one side is the energy. The other side is, of course, does it make sense from the money? Okay, there's another very recent study on the economics. And you see who is doing these studies, not the Brazilian people, the Netherlands doing it. The last one was from the people from Norway, because they are all interested in your energy market. And you know that with the government has changed, now parts of the energy market are to be sell to people. So though the people are interested, other countries interested, what is the energy market in Brazil? So they make the studies. They found a lot of these studies, very recent studies on does it make sense to produce something, to ship something, what is the how does it work in Brazil, the energy market, and things like that. Okay, this is one of the systems here, or one of the study from the Netherlands, and they said, okay, it's a private house, condominium somewhere, and you put some of these PV modules of a certain size on your rooftop. So then you need money for this investment. What is that money? How does it cost? And how many years it is needed to pay back the money? Not the energy, the money. And then, of course, this is changing all what is the value of the money and all the things. But this is a very recent from 2015, 1 year ago. And you see, they come up. You can get here the numbers. To about 6 to 8 years. So it makes sense for people to, if they have the money, to install something, because after 6 to 8 years, they're getting their money back, because they have a forecast, what are the energy prices in the future, what is the electricity costs here, and this is all taken into account in this. So these are the calculations, the forecasts to have some models. Of course, they want to advertise, and because companies want to come and install such things on private rooftops. Okay. Okay. Good. 6 to 8 years. Okay. So in Germany, the thing started very early, about in the end of the 90s, and we had the 100,000 roof program. So the government said, we give you for 20 years a constant fed-in tariff. That means every kilowatt hour you produce with your solar panel module on the roof, and you put it in, fed in into the grid, we pay you 50 cent euro cent. This is a lot. 50 euros, and it was the one, you see all the others are got 7 euros and 6, 8, solar got 50 euros and for 20 years. So by that it was most of the people said, okay, we can do that, because over about the same 6 to 8 years, we had to break even with our money. Okay, so people install that and say, after 6 to 8 years, I have not to pay so much anymore, because the money I spent, the money I got in, because I got this guaranteed prices here. Okay, this of course was a boom in Germany, because this was a huge market. Although we learned it's not so efficient to do that in Germany, because the sun is not so shiny, so intense in Germany, but they put it everywhere. And if you go however you have been in Germany, in each village, I think 20 to 30% of each houses have these PV modules on the top. So these PV modules, not for the water heating, we'll talk about that if we go to solar heat. Okay, because it was this guaranteed, and this was done by the Renewable Energy Source Act. we have seen in the first lesson already, it was Germany wants to go down with the shares of the fossil energy to 2050, 50% should be renewable, and one of the measures was introducing that here. Okay, so this was the facts till 2011. Everything worked nicely, coming up with the numbers of what peak power in this rooftop PV modules, and build up a huge industry as well. So this was 2011, and that some of these facts, which was then the outcome of the Renewable Energy Source Act, and you see that there was 23% of the whole electricity was produced, and it was a lot of people employed in this sector, and they developed the techniques for that, so they got leading market companies. And this EEG serves as an archetype for other countries. Okay. So then 2012 comes the crisis. What started? This, what was started in Germany, started everywhere else as well. In China, and that was the thing, in China they produced a lot of PV. So they could fill the whole market. So it was an overproduction of PV cells, and by that the price is going down. Okay. Here you see the price development from 2008 to 2015 last year. This is like the euros per watt peak comes from 2.5 euro to about 0.5 euro. So only one-fifth, of course. Not all the companies can produce at such a low price here. Why China, Taiwan can produce at such low? Because they're the only one which are left at the end. Because they have, it's a governmental companies, if you so want, and they have not to take any credits if they want to build something. So they have much better conditions like any other private owned company in the rest of the world. And by that, all the PV modules which produced in Germany and in Japan are so much too expensive comparing to those in China or in Taiwan produced. Okay, but that, it was like, people say this is the global market, someone producing cheaper, and by that a lot of people lost their jobs in Germany, and the companies were going down. Okay, you see in 2011 already here about 60% of the total production comes from China. Okay, the price and the global volume. There's a law, the law is called Swanson's law, and you see this is a double logarithmic plot. Cumulative module shipments in megawatt peak over the module costs, and you see we're coming down here about euro and dollar, one-to-one counted, 20, 30, 40, 50. We're here at about 50. If here it's produced about 100,000 megawatt peak. Okay, so that's what is the global production. If something producing bigger, bigger, and bigger, the price is coming down, which is good on the other side. Doesn't matter where the employees are. This is good because the technology becomes cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. Okay, so in 2015, now that's current situation, last numbers I could find, 2015, you see the biggest producer coming from China, Trina, Jia Solar, Jinko Solar, Jingli Solar, or from Taiwan, and there's just First Solar and Canadian Solar producing under the top 10 of the big producers left. So in the global In the total annual production you see here, China and Taiwan makes about 45 gigawatt peak from the 100, so 50%, and then the rest is down here. No? So it's mostly the PV modules produced in China and Taiwan. Okay, that means also for these guaranteed fed-in tariffs that it's not possible anymore to pay more these 50 euro cent because the prices for the cells are down. So the prices for the photovoltaic coming down, and by that also the prices for this fed-in or these fed-in tariffs have to come down, and that is given here because the price for the energy. They meet the price for the energy. In the beginning, 1999 or so, solar power was much too expensive. So there has to be subsidies to bring it down. But not then there was a break even around 2012 with this crisis because the energy or the costs for the PV module meets the energy or the costs for producing energy by fossil industry or so on. So it's not needed anymore, the subsidies. So Germany stopped with that. You see it coming down to 2012, was at the end about 10 cent, euro cent. And then in 2014 they started and say, okay, we'll not do guarantee any price anymore. We start with auctions. So the government launch an auction and say, we'll want to install 2 or 3 gigawatts, and then we pay for that for 20 years a certain price. And it goes, the numbers going down. They start, I don't know, with I don't know, 10 cent per kilowatt hour, and the company who said 10 cent, then comes 9, 8, 7, blah, blah, blah. And the one which the company which is left at the end, which needs the less or money guaranteed for bringing their electricity to the grid, they get the contract. And this system Brazil started in 3 years ago. Okay. So they started with that, and I think the first auction was in 2014 or 2015. And you see what has been here, some of these. This is August last year. One of these auctions, 800 megawatts of PV at 8 cents per kilowatt hours. So Brazil said will not guarantee a general fixed fed-in tariff. We make an auction, say we need some energy somewhere, and we make an auction to all companies in the world who is producing or who wants to produce this PV plant producing this amount of energy, watt peaks, at and giving them the lowest guaranteed fed-in tariff. Okay, this is a good thing, I think, by that. So everyone is a competitor. At the end, everyone, at the beginning, everyone is there. Okay, I need 20 cent, but if it comes down to the 8 cents, then just one or two companies are left, and they get the contract. Okay. And then they got the contract to build this plant in the next 2 or 3 years. And then the government said, okay, we pay you for 10, 15 years, whatever is in the contract, this amount of money for the electricity you produce. Okay. Good. And you see some of these here. Another song is here. 1.1 gigawatts was in this auction. And one of the first plants is in Ceará. This is also, I think, the northeast or state of Ceará. Yes, okay, so there's one of the first. So, but this is really, really a new development, okay? Excuse me? Okay, here's something. Spain's and Italy's green energy one, where two of the successful companies in these auctions. They got, these are several projects. They said we need their plant there, there, and there. So several objects, okay, and they got some of these objects. Okay, because the situation before they started with that, and I have not found a really good number, but Brazil was about somewhere, they got very, very down. As we said, 0.1%, it was not any market share so far, but they started now in 2013, 14, 15, we saw with this auction. Now they built up these plants with about here it's 1.1 gigawatts, here it's 0.8 gigawatts, will be 2 gigawatts already, these two auctions. And you see here, 2 gigawatts will be 2,000 megawatt. Okay, India has 5,000 megawatt. Okay, they want to come up with this because it is also useful to use it. Energy payback time, the money which you spend, and the system of introducing this new technology by these auctions is, I think, very useful. Okay, good. So these are the companies which have total installed capacities in China the most, and this is the result of the fed-in tariffs over the years. And if you go it per people, per capita, per people, per heads, you have in Germany the most of the PV cells installed. Okay, that means that there are regions which has a lot of PV installed capacities, and there are regions where nothing is installed, as you see here. And this is 0.1% for Brazil. Okay, so on one side, solar is shining in most of these regions here, but the most of the solar cells are installed in the north or in the south, if you take it per inhabitant here. So what is missing clear are concepts like this, as we talked about sustainability. So what is missing is, in my opinion, to give people a chance to have electricity if they are living off-grid. Off-grid means they have no connection to the electricity grid. And if you have no connection with electricity, you have to produce your light at the night by running a motor engine or something. You're burning fossils or making a fire or whatever, and it's so easy and it is so inexpensive, as we have learned, to ship simple robust PV modules all over the globe, especially to Africa or to the Central East regions. Well, they're really off-grid regions where they have no access to electricity. To run in the night LED lamps to charge some mobile or whatever you can do with that energy. Well, this is the first step, I think. So people have to, there are some plans of the United Nations and so on, that big companies, and that would be very fantastic, not to produce a lot, but also to produce a lot in such companies, to bring them at least, if they have no grid, bring the chance to have electricity. And by that, PV plays a role, and by that, the glass on top of these PV modules plays also some important role. Okay, this is all around markets and so on. We have seen that this is all driven by markets and by subsidies, by auctions, and now we are coming to the PV cells itself. Okay, what type of PV cells we have? Marketed, so you can buy them. Only the generation one, which are the so-called crystalline silicon cells. These are wafer technology. You grow a single crystal, you cut them, and that is the wafer technology, or the so-called generation two, thin films. Thin films which are deposited on a substrate, mostly glass or substrate, and then you turn it. So these are the depositions on the glass. You start with a glass, and then it goes all the with a physical vapor deposition, PVCD, PV, physical vapor deposition techniques. It is built up, all these layers, we'll see in a minute. And this is the thin film technologies. Efficiencies. The efficiencies, of course, numbers are in the lab and so very high. But if you come down to the solar panels, your solar roof system, you can say that we are around these numbers for the efficiency, about 16, 17, up to maybe 20% for the crystalline silicon, and a little bit less for the thin film. If you have space, then do more to come up. So it doesn't matter which system. But of course, the market has its own regulations. 90% of all PV modules are crystalline silicon, first generation. 10% are only these. And these are not marketing at all. Okay? The organic ones. Okay, the standard PV is a crystalline PV cell. The crystalline PV cell, from the cell, we come to the panel, and the panel is produced. You see all these cells here inside, and then they have to give a panel, and to produce a panel, we see we will have to encapsulate the silicon. This is done by a polymer. In most cases, ethylene vinyl acetate called EVA or EVA. And then we have a front contact, silver paste. These are the grids which you see. And we have a back contact, and then we have a back material. On top, we have the so-called cover glass. The cover glass is for hermetic insulation of the PV model. There has not to go water inside or any humidity ambient, because there are ambient conditions, of course, and it has to be transparent, because we need the photons to come through the glass to the semiconducting silicon layer. Okay, good. Glass are not only in the cover glass, but also glass is in the silver paste. This is a little bit, but this is also, some people are working on that, and these pastes are very important, because the glass guarantee that silver makes a direct contact with the silicon. And how that works is shown here. Oh no, I have it here. One of these is, I have it there, though this is to the front contact mechanism. So you have a paste. The paste consists of about 10% glass, 2 to 10% glass, a low melting, low TG glass, something like that, very special composition, in a silver paste, in silver. So we have silver particles, you have the glass and some binder. And this makes the paste, because this is then drawn on the silicon to have the front contact. And then there's a rapid thermal annealing program. And rapid thermal annealing, they are brought in and very shortly heated up. During this very shortly heating up, now comes the mechanism. The silver particles, silver plus ions, so there's an electron transfer from the glass to the silver. Silver plus goes into the glass. We have a dissolution of silver into the glass under the oxygen or on the conditions up here. Then the silver plus migrates in the liquefied glass at higher temperature above TG, and then we come to the more reducing surface of the silicon, and there is a reprecipitation of silver. So the silver comes out of the glass. And by this process, it's etching away the little oxide layer, atoms layer, 6 oxide layer. So we have a direct contact at the end between silver and the silicon. And this is the work of the glass because of this dissolution reprecipitation mechanism. Okay? Otherwise, we have not as nice context. And this is given here a little bit. You see the silver. This is a glass. Here, reprecipitation of silver directly on the silicon. Okay. And by that, we have a good contact. And by that, we can bring out the electrons and the charge. Okay, good. So now coming back to the front glass, why glass at all? And of course, this has to do something with the so-called optical window transparency of glasses with respect to the solar spectrum, which we have seen. The black is the solar spectrum. The UV edge has been extended here large, and you see all the materials here which are used or which can be used. Of course, we have the quartz silica glass, goes up, comes down at 160 nanometers, but it will be much too expensive to run PV modules with the silica glass, and it's not needed because you see the AM1.5 direct spectra here ends at about 300 nanometers. So we need only materials which have their UV edge below 300 nanometers. And that is good for a standard soda lime glass, where around maybe here 290 something, or a borosilicate glass. Where's the borosilicate here? The blue one's a borosilicate glass. And it's not so good, of course, if you use a standard PMMA. You see, we lose this part, of course, but of course there are also UV transparent PMMA materials. On the other side, you see the absorption bands here, and you see that the optical window of the glasses, this is all calculated for a standard, which is about 3.2 millimeter thick cover sheet, takes all the rest down to 2,500. Okay, so glasses are, from the optical perspective, are very good materials for that, useful materials. They fulfill all the regulations or the requirements, better the requirements, to have a transparency between 300 and 2,500 nanometer. And that's what you measure at the end, because you want to have the full solar transmittance at the end, if you measure a glass. We'll see then at the end of the lecture. Okay, that we had. So glasses are good. The crystalline silicon again. The silicon, wafer-based silicon, costs, and to reduce the sizes, the thickness as over the years, is one of the measures to reduce, or has been one of the measures to reduce, the costs of silicon-based PV cells. And this is shown here, and they are around 150 to 200 microns. Or this is thick. We'll see thin films around 3 to 6 microns something. So 160, 3 to 6. Yeah. Okay, here are the thin films. Mostly we have amorphous microcrystalline silicon. We have tellurides and we have sulfides. Semiconducting layers, by that the cells are named, cadmium telluride cells. Or here we have a gallium selenide cell in this C6 cell on the left-hand side of the transparency. And you see that for the thin films, mostly these thin films are covered by a front glass and by a back glass. So we have two glass sheets. Of course, there are also cells on the market which have a metal back. Others, as we see here with the C6 as well, will have a front glass and we have a back glass. Okay. Good, this is the selenite cells, again, front glass, back glass, you see, this is float glass, soda lime glass. We have a barrier here for migration of that sodium will not migrate. And then we have inside the semiconducting layer. And what is most important for these are the so-called TCO, transparent conductive oxides. So we have on the front side, not silver grids, paste, which are burned in, as we have seen for the crystalline silicon, we have transparent conductive oxides, so a thin layer of these, and we'll see that this is aluminum doped zinc oxide, mostly used on that, on the side, on the as a transparent conductive oxide on the front side. Okay, shares again. You see here are the crystalline silicon down to here. That's 90%, and these are second generation thin films. And then you see here cadmium sulfide. You see the amorphous microcrystalline silicon. Things like that is given here, though these are really playing just 10% of the whole market. So the whole market, what is installed worldwide, is crystalline silicon. And by that, it's a standard float glass cover, standard. We'll see, of course, if there are requirements and how to improve that in a minute. On the other side, this is always shown every year, new, what are the records for all these cell types. And you have a single junction, a double junction, multi-junction cell types to cover the whole solar spectrum. But of course, these are a lot of different layers which has to be deposited over, and this costs a lot. So of course, you can go up with these multiple junction cells to very high efficiencies. But what is the price of that, and is that already on the market? We see no, it is still on the market are the ones which are, I think, here in blue, crystalline silicon, and there we are around 20% or something like that in the efficiencies, okay? Good, for the thin films, the TCO is deposited on the glass. So this deposition on the glass, you see here, this is a glass. Then we have this TCO, which is the zinc oxide, aluminum doped zinc oxide. And then on that grown here, micromorphous crystalline, micromorph silicon. And then there's again the TCO zinc oxide layer. So we have concepts like here. And the thing is, if we have now mixtures of different type of semiconducting materials, we'll cover the whole spectra to convert it into electricity. This is also given here, like an example here, for a multi-junction cell, thin film cell, and you see there's a gallium indium phosphide, a gallium indium arsenide, and a germanium layer or semiconducting layers inside. And by that, you have always here the energy which is needed maximum to produce the electrons and the holes. So we can cover this with the first, this, and that for the third, so we can cover all the spectrum. Okay. Clear that we have for the silicon, we can use only the energy which is above 1,100 nanometers. That means shorter wavelength, so this part has too low photo energy, and we cannot take it. Okay, for the each semiconductor, of course, has a different kit here for their energy. Okay, so these are the concepts, though in the most thing we're running with that in 90% of all cases installed, a very simple thing because price is one side, and this is most important for all these SEC auctions are running. And so of course you can run, you can think of very interesting cell concepts, but on the other side, it has this a chance on the market. Well, that's always the question. Okay, now comes to the glass. And the glass has an important role in such way that external reflection has to be decreased. So we do not want to lose photons on the surface of the glass because of reflection. It will not transmit through the semiconducting layer on one side. And on the other side, the TCO material and also geometry of our glasses on top takes care that there's a lot of internal reflection. Okay, so the photons are somewhere, have multiple reflections inside that to have this photon management to get as most as possible of these photons to our semiconducting layer or to the silicon material here. So we have figured glasses, we have flat glasses, and we have glasses which are coated on top with an anti-reflective layer. How that works, we'll see the next time we'll talk about surface. Okay, so one of the concepts here, though the TCO material has to be deposited on the glass in a certain way, that to increase the internal reflections, though people are running with float glass in these depositing chambers to deposit or to grow, to crystallize these TCO materials in a certain way and to increase the internal reflections as seen here. Okay, with that concept, there are two ways of, as we have seen, two ways of PV modules on the market. And by that we have two categories of front glasses. One are the so-called floated, clear, flat float glass. Normal soda lime silica glass will come up in a little bit on the composition of that glass, what we'll have to take on here. So this is normally used for the thin film cells. Okay, you have a transparent material. This is covered in most of the cases with a anti-reflective coating on top, as shown here. And it is coated on the back side with that TCO, with that structure, if you have seen before. Okay, this is one of the side. On the other side, we have rolled glasses. And these rolled glasses are in some way also patterned. They can be patterned. The rolled glass, well, the glass is flowing through two rolls from the furnace into rolls to giving a sheet of glass. And one of the rolls has a pattern. And this pattern is then hot embossed by embossing in the surface of the glass. And you can have that pyramidal or the pyramid-shaped surface here. But also, if these are not perfectly flat, you have a little waviness on the top. If you don't use this pattern with this waviness a little bit, you're getting here these rolled glass, and they are looking a little bit diffuse. One of the things is, of course, as we have seen here, to increase the internal reflection. Other thing is, if you use this type of glass, you have not direct reflections. If you have rooftop, and this is your house, and this is the neighbor, and you're producing always a reflection to the neighboring houses, that you reduce if you have such a... And, of course, the sun is moving, and with that, we have always favorable positions for bringing in the light during the day, because your rooftop system is fixed, is not changing with the sun. It's moving with the sun. It's fixed on the roof. Okay, so this has some of the advantages here. So that's what is on the market. You see, they are thickness 3.2 millimeters, sometimes 4 millimeters. You see, that is then the transmittance, about 90%, 91%, and that can be produced as flat glass, which is a float glass, or as a rolled glass. And then you have these smooth patterned or this diamond patterned glasses. Well, these are the two types of glasses from their production. Now we look a little bit to the what's in the composition then and how to improve that. We'll see. Okay. So at the end, for the glass people like us, we know the optical laws, and we know that energy can only be converted, is not lost. So all the energy which can be brought through a glass can be either reflected, can be transmitted, or can be absorbed in the glass. Okay. If we want to increase the transmittance, we have to reduce reflectance and to reduce absorbance. Okay? Because, of course, reflective plus transmittance plus the absorbance is always 100%. Okay. Energy so this is given here. And how to do it now, or what is for the reflectance? We coat it with an anti-reflective coating. We'll see next time. For the transmittance, to increase the transmittance or to reduce the absorption inside, we know that the absorption goes by the Lambert-Burr-Lambert law. And this is given here. The absorbance is the extinction coefficient, the concentration of the absorbing species times the thickness of the glass. So we have to reduce the thickness. If we have the same concentration absorbing species, we have to reduce the thickness, then less absorbing species will be heated by the photons or can use the photon energy for their transitions. Or we have to reduce the composition. That means we have to reduce absorbing species inside. That we can do. So the absorbing species is iron, which takes part into the spectra. And you know that iron is a polyvalent element in the glass. We have 2+ and 3+. And if you look to the transmittance spectra of a glass as a function of the wavelengths, this is transmittance. Okay, then we have 92% here. 8% is lost by reflection. Okay, and then we're going up here as we have seen here. So that's the normal one. But now we have the iron inside because we use a normal sand. The sand as we have learned first lecture, you use a normal sand, you have impurities of iron inside. Iron is dissolved in the glass as 2+ and 3+. Iron 3+ are having some bands here and taking part on the UV edge. And iron 2+ has a broad band at around, this is around 360 nanometers, and this is around 1060 nanometers. So this is nanometers. Okay, this is in the near infrared, and this is at the UV edge somewhere, visible to UV. Okay, the tail of that goes into the visible range. If we have a reduced molten glass and most of the iron is in the 2+ state, we absorb in the red, so the glass looks blue. On the other side, if it is an oxidized glass, the glass looks yellow, and we have this absorption here and these shorter wavelengths. Okay, so this is the mix. If two are inside, then of course we have the green appearance of our standard float glass. Okay, so as the important thing is now to reduce these bands, and this can either be done on, the question is, of course, this comes from the sand quality. Okay, then you have to reduce, or you have to optimize, or getting more a pure sand, which is costs a lot, or you can shift these bands. That means you can play a little bit with the with that ratio, the fraction of 2 plus to the total iron, 2 plus plus 3 plus, by oxidizing or reducing. What PV industry does, it is oxidizing the glass, because for the most cells, 1100, so this part is used from the silicon, so well, this is counting more in taking photons for making a DD transition, intra-ionic transition, you know, coming up and using these photons, and by that it can be used by the silicon layer below. So people are using oxidizing agents to coming up, to bringing that on the more oxidized glass, to oxidize the glass, to having more 3 plus than 2 plus, to reduce this ratio here. Okay, this is sometimes done by antimon or other things, and of course if you think of a green product, we should not use something like that, so you have to think on other oxidizing elements which can oxidize the iron and will be reduced. Okay, so this is thinner glass, lower iron IR coating. So that's the thing where the solar people are running. So the standard quality we have seen here, this is the one which is sketched here. And then we have the low iron glass for the solar industry, as I say, always a low iron glass. Roughly, it is about a iron content of 100 ppm weight, and these glasses are toughened, thermally toughened, the front glasses, normally the IR coating, and the toughening is done in one step, burning in the IR coating. The IR coating is mostly a sol gel coating, by dip coating or by spraying, by rolling or whatever, and then this is burned, is consolidated in the same step as toughened, as toughening the other glass. Okay. So that's one of the thing. Of course, we have learned also, if you have a thinner glass, it's better. Though the first modules or their producers, which say we have a 2 millimeter cover and a 2 millimeter back from 3.3 to 2.2. Or to 2.3, something like that, for that reason. So we have a little bit higher efficiency. Okay. So then at the end, there was, as always, a little bit on the research. So we have normal, as we have learned, it's normal. It's a low iron soda lime silica glass, either a float glass or rolled glass. Float glasses for the thin film modules, rolled glasses mostly used for the PV modules, from crystalline silicon as a cover. Then comes the encapsulation material, EVA, and then we have the silicon, and For the glasses, we have learned thinner, of course, means less absorption and higher quality in the sand means also lower absorption. Okay, so we had tested all this PV at that time, around 2012 or so, 2010, 2012, we got samples from all PV producers, which we got, about, I think we had 14 floated and 6 rolled glasses, and we're checking what is really the composition of these glasses and what is this. It was a competitive study for one of the producers which we made in our lab. Nowadays I can talk about this because it's all gone, all history. But at that time it was shown, oh, is our glass as competitive to all the others? You know, that was the type of study. Okay, at the end, or at the starting, we saw that all glasses are soda lime silica glasses. This is the silica, this is soda, this is the lime, as you want. So we'll start up here. Okay, we brought this together, of course, the lime is also magnesium, and soda also counted to, together with the potassium oxide. But to come into this ternary diagram, you see they are all close together. Okay, none, and these, all these compositions were run with laser abuse ICP, this mass spectrometer, to have the really good composition of, especially for the traces. On the traces we are most interested. Okay, now you see what is the network former, and you see that the network former, though the max, though the sum is between 70% and 74%, both, and this is the alumina fraction, and see there, glasses produced with low alumina, we say with low feldspar, with low whatever the alumina source was as a raw material, and others they have relatively high, 1.5. Okay, but most are about 0.5 alumina, and the total around 71 to 72. Okay, this is one side. Now comes to the upper, these are the alkalis. And you see, there, most glasses are produced with low potassium concentration, low potash. So we are between, there are glasses where we are just with sodium inside, no potassium oxide, and others having about 0.5, so there are quite differences. And then on the other side, we have the alkaline earth, the magnesium oxide, the lime, and you see that they are also producers or glasses which use very low dolomite as raw material, so less dolomite or even no magnesium at all inside the glasses, so just lime glasses. Okay, these are the compositional things. Then comes to the iron, and the iron was measured, total iron. And you see the total iron, where all this is solar limit, or we said this is roughly the solar limit, 100 ppm weight, and most of these glasses are in that, but three of them had definitely more, so they were not as good, they were not used, or not cannot be used for solar applications, because their iron content was much too high. But most of them were in that range. This is interesting to count iron oxide plus the sulfate content. We'll see in a bit, because this has to do something with the redox, as we have learned the first lesson. The butt curve, that means the sulfur solubility depends as sulfate from the oxygen partial pressure. That means if you have a less reduced glass, you have a higher sulfate solution. If the glass is more reduced, sulfate is less dissolved in the glass, retaining in the glass, and by that the Fe2 plus getting higher. So there is a connection between the sulfur retention in the glass and this fraction. Okay. Okay, so the total iron is measured with the laser ablation ICP system, and on the other side, the 2+ iron, this band, we measured with near-infrared spectroscopy, as you have here in the lab as well. Okay, and then you see clearly, though these three guys here, they had much higher absorptions at this wavelength for the 2+ iron around 2050, and we're then all the others, okay? So this is the correlation between the ferrous iron to total iron, 2+ to total, this one, with the sulfur retention given as SO3 here in weight percent. So you see, we have this correlation more or less. So that depends what's the redox ratio of that melt, and that redox ratio shifts you the color of the glass if you want. Okay. Okay. So this is, and now at the end, we have to measure the solar transmittance, because we want to show if one glass, because of their composition, having a higher, and especially we are interested in the effect of changing the redox ratio, changing the ferrous to total iron. The glasses, and you see you have to measure that with an integration theory to get the total transmittance, not only the specular ones, which goes directly, but all the diffuse as well. And this has been collected in the integration theory. You have to measure between 300 and 2,500 nanometers. We have seen this is the solar spectrum. And then you have to normalize the transmittance which you measure per nanometer due to your light source to the intensity on of the solar radiation by the AM1.4 air mass spectrum, okay? This is given here. And by that, the calculation looks like this. You have one side your measurement, you have your standard, and then by that you can integrate over the weighted values per nanometer, which, and this, what is per nanometer, for each nanometer a number is given, and this is the AM1.5. You can download this freely from ASTM, and by that you get the a solar transmittance of your glass. And this is the number which is then important. This is the total solar transmittance between 0.3 and 2.5 micrometers. Of course, if you want special parts out of it, comparing to crystalline silicon, to thin films, to the type of semiconductor, you have to pick out that part. But this is the total one which you have to measure. And at the end, we come up to all these things here where between 89 and 91 in the mid, about 90 in the solar transmittance. Okay, only these three guys here, they were out. Okay, you see, around 90, that's what you have to see. And that's the same thing which they give here in this, as you see here. These are the numbers, okay? Well, that's what the glass can do. And now, we'll see you next time. How we can improve it by making anti-reflective coating going on the surface and to increase the transmittance by decreasing the fraction of reflectance. But the external reflection has to be decreased, the internal reflection has to be increased in the solar cell. Okay, this we'll see next time. Okay, I think I'm at the end with that PV glass. Yes. Thank you for your attention. Muito obrigado. Até a próxima.